Those of you, if you don't know who I am Tonda Thompson, and I do work for the center. I'm also a teacher at heart. So I was a classroom teacher way before I was doing what I'm doing now. So one of the things that I'm passionate about is helping kids get the most out of math and to love math, and in the process, helping teachers teach smarter and not harder. So what I want to share with you today in a very short amount of time is how to use assessment to drive instruction. So oftentimes we think that when we use our assessment, whether it's MAP testing or some other type of universal screener that you use, we do that 3 times a year. But why? How do we really even, do we use those assessments? Are they helpful? And if you're like myself, when I was in the classroom, they really were not helpful at progressing my kids and helping guiding the instruction. So what I hope to share with you today are some ways that how do we continually assess in the classroom to get the most out of our kids. So that's going to be our agenda today. How do we make assessment informative and manageable for guiding instruction? And I don't think our MAPS testing really, and I know there's lots of little avenues that you can click on and shows you some things that they're low in, but do they really guide our instruction? So that's kind of what I want to share with you today. And our focus is going to be on 5 fundamentals, and this is according to Jeannie Bae Williams's book. And her 5 fundamentals are: 1, mastery must focus on fluency. Fluency develops in 3 phases. Foundational facts must precede derived facts. Time tests do not assess fluency, and students need substantial and enjoyable practice. So if we want to use our assessments to guide our instruction, we have to know what's the map. Where are we going? So let's kind of take a look at the first. The mastery must focus on fluency. And that's a big thing, because still we have lots of teachers who think fluency is about automaticity and being automatic. But we know that fluency is selecting appropriate strategies and having flexibility with all the basic facts. So in order for us to assess, we have to understand that what are we trying to assess? So if you look at in this first part here, we talk about how it's selecting appropriate strategies. And I want to give you just a minute and look at, you see 20 subtract 3. And I'd like you for just to work that in your head. And I'm sure you have an answer already. And then I want you to look at 20 subtract 18. And I'm sure you have an answer for that. Did you work both of those the same? Did you use the same strategy for 20 subtract 3 as you did for 20 subtract 18? And I see Dee shaking her head, no. So look at your next one, 23 plus 5 and 23 plus 15. Would you work those the same? And the same goes with the multiplication. So what we have to say, and we have to ask ourselves, when some people says, why do we need to have multiple strategies? It's because we use multiple strategies. We don't use the same strategy to solve every problem. So we have to have this bank of strategies to know which one is the most efficient. So the first thing we need to do is to have an observational tool that fits what you're trying to assess. So if you have this roadmap, which is your assessment observation tool, and so when we want to guide instruction, we are assessing every day. We are somehow assessing the student every day in order to design instruction for tomorrow or for the next lesson, or even for this small little group of kiddos. Because maybe on my observation tool, we have not mastered a certain set of facts or strategies. So I'm making notations on that tool assessment that I have that such and such group still needs that additional practice. So What we're going to look at is this foundational. There are certain foundational facts that are required in order to be able to do the derived facts. So that instrument is going to let us know who is ready for that next part, that next component. So when we're looking at the components of fluency, you know, are you addressing mastery? Are you addressing where they are being able to still being at that conceptual phase? And you may have children who are mastery within this structure to five, but when you move on to components or structuring to 10, they don't have that fluency or they don't have that automaticity. So then that kind of starts back all over again. So we have to have this guideline as to what are we assessing. So once we figure out what it is that we want to assess, then it's much easier to figure out what's a tool then can I use to assess to drive instruction. So we know that fluency develops in three phases: the counting phase, the deriving phase, and the mastery phase. And again, it's important for me to know what it is I'm wanting to assess in order to be able to guide instruction on what maybe they have mastered or they have not. So let's look at the counting phase. So phase one is when the student is doing some kind of accounting. It could be counting on. It could be counting all of them. It could be skip counting, but they're having to do some kind of accounting. So when I'm giving that assessment, I'm looking to see how many kids are still in phase one that are still having to do some kind of accounting in order to figure out how many are there. Phase two will come once that the child is able to do the counting. So when you think about the counting, think about what it involves. It involves one-to-one, it involves cardinality, it involves being able to hold a number and count on from that. So once I'm able to do that, now I'm ready to be able to work on on deriving facts. So as you notice here, they have to have the foundational facts, and we're going to get to that just in a second. What are those foundational facts that they need to know before they can use deriving facts? So, and those strategies would be something like, if I know my doubles, so I know 4 + 4 = 8, how is that going to help me with 4 + 5? If I know 4 × 4, how is that going to help me with 3 × 4? So being able to use derived facts is being able to use a known fact that they already know. And again, what type of instrument can we use as we're teaching, as the kids are working, that we are making observation every day to check to see, do they own those kinds of strategies? And then again, I like this one, which derived fact strategies is the student using for which problem types? So again, they may be using a derived fact, but they're always using it for a make 10 strategy. So maybe they're not using their doubles, or, you know, what type of problems is it that they can do, but they can't do them all? That's important information. And that's assessment. That's real life assessment. Right as it's going on every day. And then of course we get to the mastery. And this is where we definitely want the kids to know that with 3 seconds, very little hesitation. So oftentimes I hear the public, and I know you've heard this too, why do they have to go this long way of working everything out? Well, we don't want them living there. We know that's a process in which they have to go through, but we don't want them living there. We want them to still have fun way and a conceptual understanding about number sense and really have that strong number sense of how I can work numbers, pull them apart, put them back together, just lots of different things. And then I want to get to that mastery level or to that automaticity level to where the correct response is within 3 seconds. So we are going to get there, but we should never start here. There are those other two phases in which we must go through in order to get to phase 3. So what are those foundational facts for addition? Well, it's very important that we work on first with the plus, the addition and subtracting from of 0, 1, and 2. So we definitely want to make sure that for any number we give them, they can add or subtract 0, 1, or 2 from that number. We want them to be very facile with their doubles. So we want them to know that. We want them to know their combinations of 10 and then 10 plus. Those are foundational facts in which they must have in order to be able to use the derived facts that we're wanting them to move to. And again, how do we know if they know these facts? We have to do some type of assessment. When we're doing an activity that's requiring doubles or make 10, do we have something in where we can take notes as to if they're fluent with that? Are they, what is their struggle with that? And then we can actually take a look at it and design instruction for the next day based on where they are today. Let's look at the multiplication basic facts that they should know before being able to use derived facts. And that is their twos, tens, and fives, ones and zeros, and their squares. So definitely want to make sure that all of those foundational facts are covered before moving to the derived facts. So what do we do instead of time test? Because so many times, and I have been guilty of that, folks, teaching third and fourth grade, of giving time tests every single morning. Well, every day I would have somebody to cry every single day that I did it. So what I would do for that one child is I would think, and I thought I was doing right. I thought that was the best way would be that I would say, okay, you don't have to do all of these. I'm going to cut yours in half and you only have to master this part to try and to relieve some anxiety. But little did I know that was really the, I mean, it might've been helping somewhat, but that was not what I should have been doing. You know, I should be doing a lot of observation, interviews. I could have done some journal writing for the child to see what their thinking was. Some strategy quizzes. So if I could give a quiz that looked at their strategy versus did they know it or did they not know it? And then just some self-assessment. So those are some things that we need to do in order to be just so focused on time test. And I did it. I mean, I did it every single day. I felt that was the what I was supposed to do in order to help them with those multiplication facts. And this is the part I love. And it's that they need to do have enjoyable practice. If they are going to master a skill, and I see this even now, I do some tutoring, and I have a sixth grade child that I've been working with. And he loves it when I bring in a game. And every day he wants to know, you know, what game are we playing today? So we do some other things. And then we make sure that I tried to always assess with him. I knew even though he was sixth grade, he was truly struggling with being able to add with a non-count by one strategy. So if we had 27 and eight more, he always said 27, 28, 29, 30, and he would count eight more every time. So I thought once we get beyond what his requirement is for sixth grade, that he's working on some fractions and we were working on some things like that, then I pulled the game Zeus on the Loose, because Zeus on the Loose is such a fun game and they don't realize it. But in that same time, I'm saying, well, you add eight more. Let's think of a quick way to add that so you're not taking so much time. So I was actually felt like I was doing some teaching with those counting strategies. When you think about it, he's still phase one. He was still counting on by ones. So I'm having to fix that to help him even with his multiplication because he's still doing some count by ones. So you probably have the Math Fact Fluency book, but I kind of want to show you with the assessments. It's been wonderful because KCM has been working with, as you know, Jenny Bay Williams for this year, and they have developed, we've had some of our RCs, and I think Bonnie's on here, and she's one of them, has been, and let me open this up and pull up. They have been working on putting the games, 40%, am I right there, Bonnie? 40% of the games that are in the book and some of the assessments are here on our site. Bonnie, am I saying that right? Dee, am I saying that right, I think? Okay, yes. So what I want to share with you is here is the assessing the foundational facts. This gives you an assessment that you can look at. I'm going to go to this chapter 7 in the book, and I want to show you here. They have progress monitoring tools for addition and multiplication, just what we talked about. So here is my assessment tool that every day I can use. And it's on here free. I was just telling Dee about free because KCM gives so much for free that, you know, we attended the STEM conference today and I felt that we had to pay for everything in some form or fashion. But I was so used to being, you know, everybody getting things free that it was like, where's the free? So what I love about this is you see the foundational facts there. You see your fact subset here. Do they count all of them? Do they count on from the first number? Or are they counting on from the greater number? And it tells you, here's the phase one that we're working in. Here's phase two. They can recognize the fact set, like this is a double. And can they use the fact set to add or subtract? Here's that for you. And then phase three is that automaticity or that mastery. And Dee is showing Zeus on the Loose. If you're not familiar with Zeus on the Loose, oh my gosh. If you're working within counting to 100 from different numbers, you must have that game. We love it. We love it. It's a good family game if you want to play. And it's easy to play. And it's great with adding your math skills. So I love this. Here's your sheet right here for you, free. So you can actually do your observation, progress monitoring, and then you can design where do I need to go tomorrow with what I know they know today. Who's going to be in my small group instruction? You also will see the instrument for derived facts strategies. And again, so sums within an add-in of 7, 8, or 9, can they use those? For example, if I'm 8 plus 3, how might a child use that using a derived fact? She may use or he may use a make 10 strategy. So they may say, oh, I'm take 2 to make the 10 and 1 more. This one may say, oh, I'm going to make one more to make the 10. Again, they could do a pretend to 10 and take off one. So there's lots of different ways, but again, here's the phase one, even with derived facts. So you could be mastery with your basic facts, but when you come to the derived facts, you're back to counting again. So that's important for us to know. So we got phase one, you have your phase two, and you have your phase three. So, and again, it kind of tells you a little bit about your foundational facts, which are here. These are your foundational facts, and these are your derived facts, which is really nice for you to know if you were to have a quick PLC meeting with your teachers. This is something you could share with them. And I know we do have some schools who are doing book studies on math fact fluency. So here's some progress monitoring cards. So if you want to know, do they know their basic facts? Here are the cards to actually download and use. So I really like how this is kind of laid out there for you. Here's your doubles. So again, when you are wanting your assessment to drive your instruction, it's important that you do that every day. You know, you cannot teach without knowing what the kids know. So once you get used to that initial assessment and then you find where they are, it's hard then to teach if you don't know where they are, because it's like, I feel like I'm on a road with no map or no any place, anything that's telling me which direction to go. So when you do that assessing, it kind of helps you to know who's going to be in your groups. It helps you to know what do you need to cover for whole group instruction. so forth. Has anyone used any of these assessments, these tools? Do you have, let's see, I can't see the, let me see the chat. What about the book, Math Fact Fluency? Oof, my tongue tied here.
Yes. It's hard to say fast, right? You had some comments in the chat about loving that observation tool and that folks had the book. I think probably they haven't dug into the, some of the using all the assessments yet.
Okay, wonderful. Wonderful, because that's what I'm looking to see my chat. There it is. Okay, I'll pull it down here. Okay, I love that observation tool. Yes, good. All right, it's a key. Oh, yes, I've never heard of that game. Yeah, 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 Kimberly, you'll love, love, love it. You must have it. It's easy. And like I said, every day, you know, and we work on that counting with this little fellow that I've been working with. We work on that counting now using chunks, using a get to the 10 to help us, or pretend to 10 and take some off, because sometimes he'll lay an 8 down and he wanted to do 8 hops. And I would say, is there a faster way we could count that? And could we pretend it's a 10? But it's not really 10, it's 2 less, so we can have to take 2 off. So even in the midst of playing that game, I am constantly talking to him about and reminding him there's another strategy he could use. Is there another strategy that we could use rather than counting by ones? So love, love, love that. And I think I just went off of it. But anyway, kind of let you look here again. So just real quick, I'm going to put that back up there for you. You can also have, if you see the assessments tab, you can go there and you're going to see the progress monitoring tools. You're going to see some interview prompts for assessing fluency during gameplay. So there's a 2 prompt interview protocol. So if you are, and this really is good, if you're just wanting to interview the child to see what strategy, you can use that. It's only got like 2 prompts. It's really good. This is part I love too, is the games. So Bonnie and Leah, and I'm not sure who else has worked on that, but they have really worked on taking the games from the book and actually putting them in the game board form, which is wonderful. We didn't have that before. So here they are, combinations to 10, you're double. So if you're working in that phase 1, where you're just doing some counting and you're working on those foundational facts, then let's work on these games. And it goes back to that, how can we do that, the games to be fun. Okay, I saw Kimberly said we'll order today. Oh, Kimberly, if you're in the class, you're at MIT, you're gonna want a couple of those. They're not very high and the kids are absolutely, oh yeah, I saw where Dee said now $9 to $12. Yes, I love, love, love them. Adults love it too. We get really competitive, and I'm really competitive. The little fellow that I work with, he's competitive. And it's so funny because I never let him win. You know, I'll say, listen, if you want to win, you got to think about strategy at the end. So I'm not one to let them do that. So that's the games there. So if you haven't had a chance to look at that site now, it's on our KCM website. So yeah, like Dee said, watching students through the activities is totally formative assessment. So, and that's what we have to use in order to drive instruction. It's not that universal screener that we give 3 times a year. That's really nice. And it kind of shows us where our students are and where they progress. I mean, I was all for that as a teacher because it really did help to see if they grew. But one of the areas in which it always came back that they didn't grow very much in was number sense. But little did I know that these other ways were the way to get them to that number sense. And as an MIT for 11 years, I learned that. So very quickly, I changed the way that I taught, which I used to think I was not too bad, but I couldn't understand what I needed to do differently until the training that I went through with Math Recovery. And since then, it's just been a game changer. So, and I did see the number sense absolutely skyrocket once I changed them to have that conceptual understanding and be able to take apart the numbers and use them. Okay, and then I know I don't have it 5 more minutes. And so how many of you have had a chance to look at our website with the virtual and I'm so proud of this. Cindy is the backbone of this. She's just awesome. She does so many great things. And then we have a group that we kind of come together and say, how can we make it better? And these are created with you teachers in mind, because we say, what can we do? What do the teachers need? How can we tweak this to make sure that they understand and that, and it gets across to the teacher? So we try to make a video just in case that it's not clear. So yeah, Kimberly says she's very thankful for virtual. Yes, and we tried to do that. We got right on it and said, how can we help you, you know, virtually? So, and if you'll notice, there's a tutorial here. So make sure you click on, if you don't say, I'm not really sure what I'm supposed to do with that, watch the tutorial. And then if you still don't, shoot one of us an email and we would love to talk to you about it. So, and we're adding every day. As a matter of fact, I think we're getting to some multiplication and division ones. So
we started putting fraction things in this week.
Oh, wonderful. So see, every day. I love the little bears in the cave within five. I don't know if you've had a chance, to any of you, to look at them, but hopefully it looks like that you all have used those sites. So we're fixing to wrap up. Do you have any questions or something you want to tell me about? I feel like I have to talk really fast because 30 minutes, I'm just getting warmed up. So any questions, Jackie, you or Kimberly, tell me some things that's worked well or hasn't worked well. How do you feel about being able to use the assessments daily to drive instruction?
I love the assessments that's in this book, especially. I had purchased before all the COVID happened to do a book study with all of my teachers, my math teachers, K through five. And I thought, well, I can't wait till we can get back to normal per se, so that I can do the book study and have all this to go with it now. It's just amazing.
Yes, I agree with you completely. I love, love, love it. So, yeah. So, Kimberly, do you have the book as well?
I do have it, yes.
Okay, nice. Yeah. So they just launched these extra games to go with those. So you all probably already had a chance to look at it. But if not, get in there. And those of you, I think Jackie said she did the book study with her teachers, and that's awesome. You know, just kind of help them do that assessment. So thank you all for doing what you do. And if I can ever be of help of any sort, I'm right here. I'm not saying I know all the answers, but I know good people who do know a lot of answers, and I can help you find it. So that's pretty much it.
We are good at crowdsourcing answers to questions. That is one of the things we pride ourselves on at the Kentucky Center for Mathematics. Thank you all so much for joining us this evening, and folks that are watching this video after the fact, thank you very much for spending some time with us.
Thank you, ladies. Bye-bye.